appreciate it.
All right.
All right. Let me say thank you for the wonderful lunch. It's good. And good time of fellowship. Appreciate it so much. And thank you for staying for the afternoon service. And I know how that is after you've eaten a big lunch. It starts creeping up in your eyelids. And they get heavy. Let's look right quick over in Luke 11 again. And I want to try to give you a few thoughts and then we'll go our way. And I hope you will be back with us this week if you possibly can. I think we're going to have a good time.
Amen.
And I believe the Lord's going to help us. Luke 11, let's read again, beginning in verse 2. And he said unto them, when ye pray, say, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for again all you've done for us today. Thank you for this dear pastor and his wife and family and this church family. And Lord, thank you for the anniversary today and the 22 years that you've given this pastor and this people together to serve the Lord. And God, we pray you continue to bless them, bless the church. As they labor with their pastor, God, may they continue to labor, be laborers together with the Lord. God, we pray you continue to provide all their needs and bless them. And thank you for the fruits of their labor. And God, even this morning, looking out and seeing practically the house filled today, we thank you for that and praise you for each one. And I pray that the Holy Spirit now would use the word to minister to the needs we have in our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
This morning we dealt with the relationship that's involved in our praying, our Father and us as His children, and how important that relationship is. And this afternoon, I want to think for a minute, if we could, along the thought of what are the reasons for prayer? Why would God even want us to pray? Why, you know, as Brother Gary gave the devotion this morning and was talking about this judge that was annoyed by the woman coming to him. You would think, with all that the Lord has to tend to, why would he want his youngins running to him all the time?
Yeah.
Why would he even want us to pray? Why would he encourage us to pray? What are the reasons of prayer? And not only from his standpoint, but from you and I. What are the basically, what is the purpose of prayer anyway? Why pray? What's the purpose in it all? And I think that he gives us that purpose when you look at how he describes this prayer. You'll notice he tells us that, as we said this morning, that we ought to begin with worship. But then he said that thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth. And I think in this prayer there's at least three great things that stand out as purposes in prayer. Reasons why we ought to pray. And I think number one, as in anything, is for the glory of God.
Amen. Yes.
That God's glory might be seen.
Yes.
That God be glorified. And you know, the Bible said, whatsoever you do, whether it's word or deed, do all to the glory of God. And we know we're commanded to do that, whether it's in our manner of our daily life, whether it be in our worship, our praise, whatever it is, it's to be to the glory of God. And God so designed this thing of prayer with His glory in mind. And I want you to notice, he said in verse number 2, in the latter part here, he said, thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth. Thy will be done as it's done in heaven. Lord, I want you to do your will here just like it's being done there.
Yeah.
Lord, would you do down here what you are already doing over there? In other words, when I think about prayer, sometimes if we're not careful, we get the idea that this matter praying is me trying to get a hold of God and twist his arm behind his back and try to get him to yield to what I want. But that's not what prayer is all about. Prayer has more to do with what God wants to do in my life than in what I want done in my life.
Yeah.
You see, before we can really pray, we've got to get connected to what God wants.
Yeah.
We've got to get connected to what is God's will.
Yes, sir.
What is God's desire? What does God want to do in my heart? You know, Jesus said in one place, he said, if ye abide in me and my word abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will and it shall be given you.
Yeah.
And sometimes people get this idea, well, praying's about trying to get God to do my will, to do what I want. I want more money. I want a better job. I want a new car. I want this. I want that. So I'm going to pray and see if I can't talk God into doing what I want. But you see, real prayer is humbly waiting before God, studying his word to find out what it is God's wanting to do, and then get in fellowship with God's will and God's purpose and God's desire.
Amen. Yes, sir.
Praying is finding out what God wants and then asking God to do what he wants in our heart and life.
Amen. Yeah.
That's more what prayer is about. The purpose of prayer is that God's will be done here like it's being done there. And when it is, when earth, basically it means getting us down here to agree with him over there. When earth gets in agreement with heaven, then God's glory will be manifested. I hope I can help explain that. If you look in the Bible, I want you to go to the book of Hebrews. Stay with me a minute. And I hope if it's confusing you, I hope it'll get cleared up here in a minute. But in Hebrews, chapter number 8, Hebrews chapter 8, I want you to notice a couple of verses in Hebrews chapter 8, and look at verse number 2. Hebrews 8 and verse 2. In Hebrews 8 and verse 2, the writer says, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not man. Now, he's talking about a heavenly tabernacle, okay? He's talking about that in heaven, before there was ever an earthly tabernacle, there was a heavenly tabernacle.
Right? Right.
Verse number 5 said, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things. Now, look in chapter 9. Of Hebrews, and I'm skipping a lot, but look in verse number 23. The Bible said, it was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. In other words, before God ever told Moses to make a tabernacle down here, there was already one in heaven.
Right.
And when it came time for Moses to build the earthly tabernacle, God showed him the pattern of the heavenly. And the one on earth was basically a replica or a reproduction of what God had already done in heaven. So Moses was simply taking something that was already there and reproducing it down here. Right?
Sure.
Now, when that tabernacle was completed, the Bible tells us that when they finished it, that the glory of God filled that tabernacle. Why did God's glory fill the tabernacle? Because what God desired that was already there had been reproduced here, and when God's will was done on earth like it was done in heaven, then the glory of God came down.
Amen. Yes, sir.
So that when earth gets in agreement with heaven, then God manifests his glory. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I think another example is John chapter 1 with the Lord himself. Now, what does that scripture say? In John chapter 1 and in verse number 14, he's talking about Christ. In John 1, back up to verse 1, he said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Same was in the beginning with God. Now look at verse 14. And the Word, now who's the Word? That's Christ.
Yeah.
And the Word was what? The Word that was what? With God, right?
Yeah.
That was Christ. But the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. So he that was in heaven with the Father came down to the earth with us, right? And
right.
What happened? And we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And so there again, when the heavenly becomes manifest on the earth, then the glory of God is always manifested.
Amen.
Now, look at something else. Look in 2 Corinthians. You say, preacher, what in the world has that got to do with me? That's what I want to try to show you. Look in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. What does that have to do with me and you? What has that got to do with us? Well, look in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Now, look at verse 17. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17. Now, the Bible said, now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. Now, wait a minute. Where's this glass he's talking about? He's talking about a looking glass. He's talking about a mirror. Now, if you read the book of James, we're not going to take time to turn over there. If you read the book of James, the Bible tells us that the Bible is like a looking glass.
Right.
It's like a mirror. Okay?
Right, right.
Now, where do we behold Christ? We behold him in the Word.
Right.
Right? We look in the Word and we see Christ in the Word like you behold him in a looking glass. Now, what happens as we look in the Word and we behold the Lord? What takes place? Here's what happens. He said, we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed. Wait a minute. In other words, as I look in this Bible and I behold the Lord, then something starts happening to me. What happens to me? We are changed into the same image from glory to glory as by the Spirit of the Lord. So, as I behold the Lord in this Word, the more I look at Jesus, a transformation is taking place in my own life. The Holy Spirit is using that to change me, to make me more like Christ. Amen.
Right.
In other words, someone down here on earth is looking more like someone that is in heaven, so that which is in heaven is being done on earth or manifest in my life, then God's glory is seen when that happens.
Amen, yes.
Now, if we want God to be glorified in our prayer life, then what has to happen? Basically, you and I have to be in submission to his will. We have to be surrendered to his idea, to what he wants, so that God's desires, God's purpose, God's plan for our life might be manifested down here, you see. In other words, praying is more than me trying to twist God's arm and saying, Lord, you got to do this. You got to do this. Well, maybe it's something God's not interested in.
Yeah.
What if God's not interested in what I'm interested in? Mm-hmm. What if this thing that's important to me doesn't matter to God?
Yeah.
You see, I got to get in this book enough to know what God's interested in.
Amen. Yes. Yes.
Because I might be praying for something that he don't believe in.
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
Does this make any sense?
Sure it does.
Do you understand why sometimes people say, well, I don't believe in prayer? Well, why not? Well, I asked God to do this certain thing for me, I prayed 100 times. Nothing ever happened. Well, maybe what you were asking for was not something he was particularly interested in doing.
Amen. Yeah.
You know what? We have been fed this world philosophy of humanism.
Right.
To the point that we think the only opinions or desires that matter is what man wants.
Yeah.
And we fail to take in consideration that God Almighty might have a few thoughts of his own.
Amen. That's right. Amen. Yeah.
And it might do us well to figure out or find out a little bit about how he thinks.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
You know, some things people ask him for, you're just wasting your breath.
Yeah.
He ain't gonna do it.
Amen. That's right.
We got to find out what interests God.
Yeah.
What's God interested in? What does God want to get done in this world? What is God's love? What is he like?
Yep.
I'm not trying to sound mean or crude. I'm just trying to tell you a truth. That this thing of praying has more to do with his will being done on earth than my will or your will.
Right, right.
Okay? You reckon that's why Jesus said that when we pray, we should pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven?
Yeah.
Right? Whose will? His.
Yeah.
It's his. So, one of the reasons for prayer is for God's glory to be seen. Okay? Another reason that God wants us to pray, now get this, is that God's goodness might be shown to me and you. Not only does God want his glory manifested, but God wants to be good to you.
Yeah.
He wants to be good to me.
Yeah.
He wants to be good. And it's an opportunity for him to display his goodness. Now, how does he do that? Well, when he said, you praying, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven, then the next part of that prayer is what? Give us this day our daily bread. Do you know God's displaying his concern about the things so simple as the bread we eat? You think God was concerned at all about what we just did a while ago? Sure he was. Where do you think it came from?
Yeah.
Ultimately,
yep.
Comes back to the hand of God.
Sure, sure.
God's concerned about the bread that we eat. Now, here's the amazing thing. A God so great that he's occupied with bringing in, eventually he's going to bring in a worldwide kingdom. Mm-hmm. Yet at the same time, he's concerned about how much bread is on a poor widow woman's table.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen. I told you a while ago, you know, my governor wouldn't have a clue whether what I eat for lunch. Would yours wouldn't either, would it? They don't have an idea. But I'll tell you something, God Almighty, as big as he is, as great as he is, he knows exactly what we just ate for lunch.
Right, right.
He's concerned about the bread on our table.
Yes, sir.
And prayer, when we pray about the bread that we eat, God is concerned about things so simple as the food that we put in our mouths. He said in Matthew 10, verse 30, that the very hairs of our head are all numbered. And if God is so concerned that he'd be watching such minute detail is how many hairs were on our head, how could anything else be happening in our life that he's not aware of?
Right, right. Amen.
He is aware of these things, and he cares about these things.
Yeah.
And he provides for these things. In the Old Testament, God gave them manna from heaven. Manna from heaven. and he sent it on a daily basis. Wonder why God said, give us this day our daily bread. Mm-hmm. Wonder why he didn't say, just pray once a month and I'll take care of you for 30 days. I mean, you know, he's God.
Yeah.
Ain't no bigger problem for him to send you 30-day supplies, one-day supply.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Why did he say, just pray about it for one day? I tell you why. He loves you so much, he wants to hear you talk to him every day. Oh, yeah. He could just make it a New Year's deal.
Yeah.
Come to see me on January the 1st. Ask me for a year's supply. Shoot, I'll send it to you.
Yeah.
If he was like the judge that you talked about, he'd do it that way so he wouldn't be bothered with us for 365 days.
Yeah.
But the reality is, God wants some connection and some fellowship with me and you, and he wants contact with me and you every single day of our life.
Amen. Amen.
He's your Father.
Yeah.
And he'd like to hear from you today.
Amen.
In the Old Testament, God rained the manna down. They had to go get it what? Every day.
Yeah.
If you went out on the first day and you tried to get enough to last the whole week, before you got up the next morning, it'd be rotten on you.
Right.
It didn't work. It didn't work.
Right.
The only way it worked was for you to get up that day, gather enough for that day, but then you had to do the same thing the next day, and the next day, and the next day. God wants you to talk to him today. He wants to hear you again in the morning. He wants to hear you again the next day. He wants you to talk to him the next day. He wants to hear your voice every single day.
Amen. Amen.
He's a father. You're his child. He wants some contact with you. He wants some fellowship with you. That's why he said, I'll give you today what you need, but you're going to have to come see me tomorrow.
Amen.
What you need tomorrow.
Amen.
I'm going to make sure I keep you coming back.
Amen.
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 So it's a daily thing. So his goodness can be shown. But then God has designed this thing so that his grace can be manifested in our life. Grace. Where does that come in? Right here. And, watch this, verse 12, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, what else do we see involved in this thing, praying? Well, what about some forgiveness or some pardon for our sins? Forgive us our debts.
Yeah.
How many of us can go through one day without having something we need to ask God to forgive us for?
Amen.
We be honest?
Yeah.
Amen. I mean, how many of us can live even one whole day, and when that day is done, there's something we need to get on our knees and say, Lord, I failed here. You know, I said something over there I shouldn't have said. You know, I had some thoughts today I shouldn't have thought.
Yeah.
What about it? You see, on a daily basis, there's always something we need forgiveness for.
You're right.
Yeah.
And so there's pardon for our sins. But this thing not only involves pardon for our sins, but what about some patience with other sins? He said, forgive us our sin as what? As we forgive our debtors. Mm-hmm. Now here, you know, this can get difficult sometimes. You know, I not only need forgiveness, but I have to be forgiving.
Yeah.
How about those that's wronged me? Can I forgive them? Somebody once said, only those who have experienced forgiveness have the ability to extend it to others. A person who carries around a bitter, unforgiving spirit is an indication that you have not experienced forgiveness in your own life. Because once you have experienced the forgiveness of God, then you understand how important it is to forgive others.
Amen. 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 Yes.
Now, and not only do we pray about this thing of pardon and patience, but we pray about this thing of prevention of sin. He said, but deliver us from evil.
Yeah.
Lord, keep me from sin.
Right. Amen.
Lord, help me not get in a situation where I will yield to sin.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody said two things are necessary for sin to take place. One is temptation. One is opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I was reading one old preacher one time, and he said he was thanking God. He said that for the times that those two never met in his life.
Yeah.
He said, because there have been days in my life, he said, I'm going to be honest, when I was sorely tempted, but God didn't allow any opportunities.
Yeah.
And he said there were other days when there were opportunities, but I did not feel particularly tempted.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I thank God for that. Because when you get temptation and opportunity coming together,
yeah,
you've got a difficult thing to deal
That's
with.
That's exactly right.
And who can prevent that?
Yeah.
Only the Lord.
Amen.
Only
Amen.
The Lord. Thank God he's able.
Amen. Amen.
And so we see here, we see the reason for prayer. Then let me give you quickly, let me give you the conclusion of this prayer, all right? Look, if you will, in verse 13, and notice how the prayer finishes. He said, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now watch this last part. He said, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Notice that. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. What should be our attitude of heart as we get up off our knees? This is the conclusion of the prayer. This was what the Lord was teaching them to pray as they finished it out. As you get ready to get up off your knees, if you have really prayed, what kind of effect, what kind of attitude should that have produced in your life? What is the result of it? Here it is, right here. There's three things, basically. Number one, when we get off our knees, we need to get off our knees committed to the will of God.
Amen.
Thine is the kingdom.
Yes.
In other words, if you got a kingdom, you got to have a king. And if he's king, then that means I'm obligated to do what he says.
Right. Right.
If there's a kingdom and he's the king, I'm the subject.
Right.
Then I am obligated to obey the wishes of my king.
Yeah.
So when I get up off my knees, I need to get up willing to obey the will of God. And somebody said that obeying the will of God is the one characteristic or that distinguishes a true Christian.
Right.
Jesus said, not everyone that saith to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
He said that is the distinguishing characteristic of a real Christian, is somebody that wants to do God's will.
Yeah.
Amen. So when I get off my knees, I realize I've got a king. He's king in my heart, and I need to serve him. I need to be obeying his will. Now, you can live your life in different ways. You can live it doing what others would have you to do, as the world would have you to do. If you live your life that way, you're going to live it in fear.
Yeah.
You're going to always be afraid.
Right.
You will always live in fear if you base your life on what others want you to do. You can base your life on what you want to do. But if you live your life based on what you want to do, you will be a selfish person.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can live your life based on what God wants you to do, and you can have a restful life.
Amen.
Jesus said, my yoke is easy.
Yeah.
My burden is light. So you can live your life in fearfulness, in selfishness,
or restfulness.
Yeah.
And the most restful life in the world is a life that is yielded to the will of God.
Amen. Amen.
Not only did he want us to get off our knees committed to the will of God, but he wanted us to get off our knees confident in the power of God. For thine is the kingdom and the power. Where's all this power? Where's all the strength going to come from?
Yeah. Amen.
Thine is the kingdom and the power. Preacher, how in the world am I going to accomplish God's will in my life? Well, it's not going to be your strength.
Right. Right.
If it's up to me, we're in trouble.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not to rely on my strength. I'm not to rely on my power. Thine is the kingdom and the power.
Yeah.
The strength you need, the power you need, the help you need, it's His.
Right. Amen.
And He will make it available to you if you'll just ask Him.
Yeah.
So I get up off my knees. I'm to be committed to the will of God. I am to be confident in the power of God that God's going to see me through. And then he said, the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Amen.
Forever and ever.
Amen.
I'm going to be concerned
Amen.
For his glory and his alone.
Yes.
I'm not going to be worried about what somebody thinks about me. Amen. That's immature.
Right.
Doesn't really matter.
Right.
The main thing we need to be concerned about is His name, His honor, and His glory.
Yes, sir.
Because you know what Jesus said? Jesus said, if you will honor me, my Father will honor you.
Amen.
If you will honor Him, if you will do what's right, if you'll obey Him, commit yourself to His will, He will give you the power and the strength to be everything that He wants you to be.
Amen.
He will do that.
Amen.
God help us. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father. Amen.